Now we'll begin with the first part, that is complete dentures. Then I'll be going into removal partial denture and fixed partial denture. Complete denture, it is a dental prosthesis which replaces the entire dentition and associated structures of maxilla and mandible. Classification, removal complete denture it can be, or a fixed complete denture with the help of implants. What are the functions of complete denture? Aesthetics, mastication, phonetics, these are primary purpose of complete denture. A complete denture has got following surfaces. It has got an impression surface, which is also called as intaglio surface. It has a polished surface and it has got an occlusal surface. If you see the parts of the denture, they are basically four parts. You have a denture base, you have denture flanges, you have borders of the denture, and you have denture teeth. Let's look into detail. Denture base, it is that part of a denture which rests on the oral mucosa to which the teeth are attached. It could be an acrylic resin denture base or it could be a metallic denture base. Denture flanges, these are verticals extending from the body of the denture to the vestibule of the oral cavity. Functions of them are, they help in peripheral seal and horizontal stability. The vestibule, they are classified into labial flange, buccal flange or lingual flange. So here you can see these are the flanges. The third part, that is the denture teeth. Based on the material, the denture teeth can be classified either they are into the acrylic type or a porcelain type. There are also certain different types like interpenetrating polymer network resin teeth, gold occlusion teeth, acrylic resin with amalgam stop teeth. Denture teeth, they can be also classified based on their cuspal angles or morphology, that is anatomic teeth, semi-anatomic teeth and 0 degree teeth. Now in the basic, before entering into the complete denture fabrication or doing an impression making and all, you should know the basics of anatomical landmarks. So what do you mean by anatomical landmarks? See, these anatomical landmarks are the normal structures which are present in the oral cavity, which when reproduced outside, aid in fabrication of a prosthesis. So these are actually the normal structures in the oral cavity. When you make an impression and a cast out of it, by studying the cast, you will know that what is normal, what is abnormal, right? So you all have gone through anatomy. In the Edentulous patient, we have certain landmarks to be seen, like incisive fossa is there. You have an incisive bone, you have the palatal plates, you have the suture, you have the posterior nasal spine. As the age progresses and the teeth are lost, then you get residual alveolar ridge, mid-palatine raphe, incisive foramen, palatomaxillary suture, maxillary tuberosities, hamular process, you have hamular notch, you have posterior nasal spine, you have greater palatal foramen and so on. Same thing when we overlap them with, those were the hard tissues, when we overlap with them with the soft tissues, you can see n number of soft tissue structures which are of anatomical significance, such as incisive papilla, you have palatal rugae, you have hard palates, you have soft palate, you have maxillary tuberosities, etc. This is how it looks in the intraoral picture. You have incisive papilla here, a mid-palatine raphe here, you have palatal rugae here, you have frenums, you have vestibule. Similarly, in the lower arch, once the teeth is lost, residual alveolar ridge, you have frenums, buccal frenum here, vestibule, buccal shelf area, etc. So we are going to study these landmarks which will help you when further discussion of the teeth arrangement and occlusal rim starts up. Now, anatomical landmarks of edentulous jaws, these are often given cast in your viva also to identify the structures, and you should know the significance regarding that. More detail, that is the histopath of that and all, is not really much needed, but at least the basics part you should know. So when we see the anatomical landmarks in the upper edentulous arch, edentulous is without teeth, complete denture we are talking about. So this is incisive papilla. You have an mid-palatal raphe. You have palatal rugae. You have alveolar crest. You have labial frenum. You have a labial sulcus. You have buccal frenum. You have buccal sulcus. You are having hamular notch here. You have fovea palatinae. This area is cupid bow shape, called as posterior palatal seal area. Again, tuberosity maxillary over here, and so on the structure. Similarly, when I am going to talk about mandibular arch, you will have again labial frenum, labial sulcus, buccal frenum, buccal sulcus, buccal shelf area, retromolar pad, myloid ridge, you have alveolo-lingual sulcus, lingual frenum, and if palpable, then you have genial tubercle and torus mandibularis. Now, when we study landmarks, they are broadly classified into three categories. One is the limiting structure, which limits the extension or the borders of the denture. Supporting structures, which take up the load of the prosthesis. And relief areas, which are having underlying certain important anatomical structures like nerve, vessels and all, which needs to be relieved. So first, let's see limiting structures. So limiting structure, they guide us in having an optimum extension of the denture. If the denture is underextended, the denture will lose its retention and support. If the denture is overextended, it will impinge on the tissues, or during function, it can get dislodged. So which are important structures, limiting structures? Important limiting structures are labial frenum. So here, this is the labial frenum. So in the denture, it should be relieved, okay, by a gentle V-shaped notch. You have labial vestibule, which extends from your labial frenum till buccal frenum. You have an anatomical structure called as buccal frenum. These buccal frenum, they may be sometimes multiple in nature, and their levator anguli oris and orbicularis oris buccinator muscle fibers are inserted. So they are much more shallower and wider in nature. You have buccal vestibule, which extends from buccal frenum till the hamular notch posteriorly. You have an hamular notch. It is depression between the maxillary tuberosity region and the hamulus of the pterygoid plate. And the another limiting structure to complete is the posterior palatal seal area. Posterior palatal seal area are the soft movable tissues along the junction of hard and soft palate, on which the pressure can be applied within physiologic limit, which helps in aiding denture retention. It consists of the boundaries, an anterior vibrating line, a posterior vibrating line, and pterygomaxillary seal. Pterygomaxillary seal, it is part of the posterior palatal seal area that extend across the hamular notch. It extends 3 to 4 millimeters anterolaterally to end in the mucogingival junction on the posterior part of the maxillary ridge. Posterior palatal seal is that part of the posterior palatal seal area that extend between two maxillary tuberosity. You have an anterior vibrating line and a posterior vibrating line. Anterior vibrating line can be recorded with an exaggerated ha motion of the patient, and posterior vibrating line is recorded with when the patient tells in a gentle burst, ah, ah. So the distal significance of this landmark is the distal extension of the denture should extend to the vibrating line. It should not overextend or underextend. Limiting structure now we'll see in the lower arch. you have a labial frenum. You have labial vestibule, which runs from labial frenum till the buccal frenum. You have buccal frenum. It may be single or double in nature. You have buccal vestibule, which extends from buccal frenum to the retromolar pad region. Lingually, we see lingual frenum. And then we see an sulcus called as alveolo-lingual sulcus. This represents the alveolo-lingual sulcus. These are the limiting areas in your mandibular arch. When we see the lingual sulcus, they are divided into three parts: anterior part, middle part, and posterior part. Anterior part is the premyelohyoid region, the myelohyoid region, and the postmyelohyoid region. These are very important landmark for your lower complete denture retention. Then you have retromolar pad area. This is a pear-shaped triangular soft pad. And the significance of this is the denture base should extend 2/3 of the retromolar pad triangular area. After knowing limiting structure of the maxillary, of the mandibular, now we move on to supporting structure. Supporting structure, as we know, the masticatory forces whenever fall on the teeth, the underlying structure should take up all this load. So we should know that the underlying structures which can take up stresses much better, they will be called as primary stress bearing area. And the structures which can moderately take the stresses will be called as secondary stress bearing area. Primary stress bearing area, these are the area that are most capable to take the masticatory load, providing a proper support to the denture. So what are the qualities of primary stress bearing area? They should have tightly adherent, sufficient fibrous connective tissue with an overlying keratinized mucosa, presence of cortical bone cover, should be at right angles to the vertical occlusal forces, and no underlying structure should be present that will get harmed due to stresses. So it should take up a lot of load. So what are the primary stress bearing and secondary stress bearing areas in maxilla? Posterolateral slope of the hard palate formed from the horizontal process of the palatine bone. Posterolateral part of the residual alveolar ridge. So this will form the primary stress bearing area. The secondary stress bearing areas are the palatal rugae areas and in the anterior region of the premaxilla and maxillary tuberosity. So they will act as secondary stress bearing area. When I look into the mandibular arch, buccal shelf area is the primary stress bearing area. So that is, buccal shelf lies between buccal frenum anteriorly to the anterior border of the retromolar pad. Medially, it is bounded by the crest of the ridge and laterally by the cheeks. Secondary stress bearing area in mandibular are the residual alveolar ridge. The underlying bone is cancellous, that's why. The third aspect in the classification, if you remember, first was the limiting areas we discussed under maxilla and mandible. We discussed the stress bearing area or the supporting area called in maxilla and mandible. And the third category, that is the relief areas. What are these relief areas? These are the areas. Relief areas. These are the areas which either resorbed under constant load or have fragile structure within or are covered by thin mucosa which can get easily traumatized and hence should be relieved. What are these structures in maxilla? Incisive papilla should be relieved because underlying this is the exit point of nasopalatine nerve and vessel. If you don't relieve it and if there is a lot of pressure in this region, then it leads to necrosis of the distributing area and paresthesia of anterior palate. Mid-palatine raphe, these are the midline suture area covered by thin submucosa. Relief again is to be provided to this structure, mid-palatine raphe. And if you don't provide it, it can lead to a rocking motion in the denture. Again, in maxilla, if cuspid eminence, that is canine, is very prominent, you may have to give relief. Fovea palatina sometimes needs to be relieved up. And in case of you are having a torus palatinus, excess bony growth, you may have to relieve those areas. Now we come to the relief areas in the mandible. Myelohyoid ridge is an irregular, rough, bony crest extending from your third molar to the lower border of the mandible. Now, this region which is there, this is the myelohyoid, third molar to the lower border of the mandible. And the mucosa, sometimes it's very thin in this region and it will get traumatized easily. So you may have to relieve this area. Mental foramen. As you see, mental foramen, it lies somewhere below the first, second premolar region over here. As the teeth sheds off and edentulous period progresses, this mental foramen may shift towards the crest, and it should be relieved, especially in case of two resorbed ridges, to prevent direct pressure and paresthesia on that region. And certain, like when you see genial tubercles, if they are very, very prominent, or if you see the torus mandibularis, again, extension of the bony structures prominent, you may have to relieve it. So these are the relieving structures. So once we know now which are the important structure, what is normal, what is abnormal, what should be the extension, what are the areas that are of significance in fabrication of a complete